Good day, everyone. My name is Yomi Oyekomi. I'm a medical practitioner and a teacher of the Word of God. You're welcome to your favorite program, Claim Your Health. The topic of discussion is episode 10 of Heart Failure. We'll be back in a moment. God bless you. Welcome back. This is episode 10 of our topic of discussion for several weeks now, called Heart Failure. A lot has gone by. So we are under the management. We started the management in episode 9 last week. And it has been interesting so far. Let me just remind you of a thing or two about that. Remember the heart again. We always start with this, just to show us the four chambers of the heart. We said there are four chambers of the heart: the right atrium, the left atrium, the right ventricle and the left ventricle. And we were conversing, we explained to ourselves how the blood flows through the heart. We said blood coming from the rest of the body up and down, first go into the right atrium, then into the right ventricle, then goes to the lung to bring oxygen, comes back into the heart through the left atrium, into the left ventricle, and then it is pumped back to the rest of the body. Then we discussed several diseases of which part of the body. That's why we have spent so many weeks on this. Several diseases of each part, from the vessels to the chambers of the heart itself, to the valves of the heart, to the electrical supply of the heart, called the SA node and the AV node. We all discussed all the problems that could ensue with them. And we specifically mentioned some areas which we have started the treatment now. And we started last week the management of heart failure. We discussed 2 points. We said, number one, we want God on our side. We must start with God. And we gave several reasons for that, because only God can have the aerial view of your problem. And we said that there are 3 sources of problem. It could be man himself, it could be the handiwork of yourself that caused your heart problem. It could be from Satan, and believe me, it could be from God, like any other problem. But what shall man do? First is to seek the side of God first, like David used to do. That he has perfected the art of staying on God's side. And we read a few verses from Psalm 51 to illustrate this. Then we may move to the second point, and we talked about the lifestyle changes, the need to look, review yourself. After you have secured yourself with God, then you come back to yourself. Where am I contributing to my problem? Is it because I smoke? Then you should stop smoking. Is it because I drink? Then you should stop drinking. Am I not eating healthily enough? Am I not taking enough exercise? Sometimes we think when money comes into our hand, that should be an excuse to start living what we call a sedentary life. We lack discipline. We send everybody to everywhere and we sit in one place all day long doing nothing. Then the heart will fail from lack of exercise. And then we said, why would you expect improvement if you are doing nothing about it? Why would you expect help from others if yourself are not doing anything about yourself? And we read from Romans chapter 6, from verses 1 and 2. Romans chapter 6, from verses 1 and 2. We said, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? If you're asking God to help you, you're asking the doctor to help you, what are you doing for yourself? This was what the lifestyle changes is all about. The point number 3 in the management of heart failure is rehabilitation. It is rehabilitation. When the heart fails, the individual will need to reboot like a computer. You need to reboot like a computer. Rehabilitation helps in achieving this. A little bit of exercise, we mentioned that in the last lesson. It could be a guided kind of exercise. We didn't say you should go to the road and start running 5 kilometers. Even just walking, or even start doing things for yourself within the house. Not sending everybody something, and why you sit down all day and like a potato, a couch potato, doing nothing. Then you start getting your own cup of tea, making food for yourself. Get involved with the activities of the house. Even if you are the head of the house, it is your house and it is your family. What is wrong in standing up and doing something with the rest of the family? This is very common, especially in Africa. Then educate yourself about your condition. Educate yourself about your condition. One of the first line of defense is to know the opponent. Once you understand the opponent, it becomes very easy. This is just what science do. When a new disease comes, they want to know, how does it replicate? How does it disease? How do we get this? What causes this? Then they will start looking for intervention to block the pathway of that problem. By educating yourself, you have understanding of what is causing your own heart condition. You read about it, then you start taking steps. Knowledge is always light. Knowledge is always light. That is what Hosea chapter 4 verse 6 was saying. He said, my people perish for lack of knowledge. Little things may be bothering you. Until you are in the light with that thing, you are always going to be scared. You are going to be subjective onto that thing. Then relaxation. Some people, their problem may be because they are workaholic. They want to have it all. They are workaholic. It could just be by nature. Or they may be being pursued by the rat race of making more money. They never taking out time to even look at themselves. I always joke about that in the last episode. I mentioned it in one of the episodes. That many people know how to make money, but they don't know how to enjoy it because they will not do the right thing. So they're always chasing money until they drop dead one day and somebody will come and spend that money on their behalf. May that not be your portion in Jesus' mighty name. Then you need emotional support. Surround yourself with good family. Pick yourself a doctor that is listening to you, and then you can go there and just talk if you just want to feel like talking or hearing other people's opinion, and let your family rally around you to make sure that you follow the instruction of God in your life and that of the doctor in your life, and do what you need to commit yourself to do. This is where the emotional support comes from. The patient is expected to continue all this even after rehabilitation. You make it a part of your way of life so that this thing may not come. Heart failure most of the time is a lifetime thing, but we said that is the report of science and that is the report of man. Whose report shall you believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. The inner man of the patient needs to change. He needs to review his life. Such people are forced to have to reprioritize. But when it happens to them and they escape death, they will sit there and say, what is it that I'm doing that is wrong here? Is life all about money, for example? Then you start seeing them picking up other hobbies and spending more time with their family and being contented with what they have without pursuing. Because most of the time, we do competition with the others. My friend has built a 3-story building. I'm going to build 4. How many of the rooms can you stay in? Any man who wants to sleep in one room will sleep by the door and he'll be diagnosed of madness. May that not be your portion in Jesus' name. So that person, we need to reprioritize, and you need God to do that. You need God to do that. Psalm 25 verses 4 and 5. Psalm 25 verses 4 and 5. So look at what it says. Show me thy ways, O Lord. Teach me thy path. Verse 5 says, lead me in thy truth and teach me, for thou art the God of my salvation. On thee do I wait all the day. Teach me thy ways. Many people always wonder, Dr. Yomi, why do you do this thing for Mahala? It is the thing of God. Do you know the amount of time that you have to spend to gather this information? Yes. Why don't you want to do something for God? I could spend that time looking for money, but is life all about money? Of what use is it to make a million and then you run into another 2 million problem? If the Lord is not on your side, you will always be at loss. But if you make 10 cents and the Lord is on your side, you're going to be positive 10 because no problem will come your way. Isn't it easier that way? This is why I do what I do. What are you doing for God in your own time? What are you doing for mankind? What will be remembered of you? This is why I was reading this verse. It says, show me thy way, O Lord, and teach me thy path. Teach me how to live in this world. The next point of call in terms of the management is medication. This is what I was telling you, that there's a difference between treatment and management. Management is global. Medication and treatment is just one item, which is a component of management. that most people with heart failure can do well with only medication. That is a fact. Most of the time, we stage the heart condition into four stages. In stage one, even to up to stage two, many people just need some tablets and they'll be able to go about their normal life, depending on the system, on the symptoms and the primary problem of that heart condition, which we have been outlining for the past 8 to 9 weeks. So it could be ACE inhibitors. These are different kinds of medication. What we call the beta blockers, the aldosterone blockers, diuretics, hydralazine, antiplatelets, digoxins, and many, many more. That is for the decision of your doctor. You cannot just pick a medicine and be taken, because we need to know what is the cause of your own heart failure. And then it will be specifically dealt with by choice of medication which the doctor will pick. We'll be back in a moment. We have just started. God bless you. Welcome back. We were talking of medication before we went on break. Yes, the Lord approves medication. Because you see that some Christians who say, I don't take tablets, and it's fine. If their faith is strong enough, don't take tablets. But not under heart failure. If you already have a heart failure, you need medication, no matter the power, the level of your anointing. And there is nothing unbiblical about that. How do I know that? Let's look at it in Ezekiel chapter 47, verse 12. Ezekiel chapter 47 verse 12. This was a vision God gave to Ezekiel. And you will see where medical things come in there. It's 47 verse 12. And by the river upon the bank thereof, on this side and on the other side, shall grow all trees for meat, whose leaves shall not fade, neither shall the fruit thereof be consumed. It shall bring forth new fruit according to the months, because they watered the issue out of the sanctuary. And the fruit thereof shall be for meat. And look at the last statement in that thing. And the leaf thereof for medicine. The leaf thereof for medicine. Ezekiel chapter 47 verse 12. This was a vision of Ezekiel, which God showed unto him. He was able to realize that, yes, there are medicinal preparations out there. God created everything for our use. So there is nothing unbiblical about taking medication. So don't be foolish. If your heart fails, take medication. And if you need surgery, go for surgery. Praise the living Jesus. It does not reduce anointing. The doctor will not take your anointing away while you are sleeping. Trust me on that. Praise Jesus. The next point, I've run out of numbers now. The next point is pacemaker. We are talking about management of heart failure. The pacemakers. What are the pacemakers? These are small devices about that size, which is put under the skin. What do they do? Remember, I told you there are problems of the rhythm of the heart. When the firing point that controls the pulsation, the beating of the heart, when they have problem, we use pacemaker to correct it. Now, what are pacemakers and how are these done? Look at this diagram, which I've taken time to draw during the break time. Now, this is the chest of a man or a woman. This is the chest, this is the abdomen. I've cut the chest there. Now, this is the sternum. This is the bone here. The bone in the middle of the chest is the sternum. Now you have the ribs coming to join the sternum. Behind the sternum, a little bit onto the left side, is the heart. Isn't it? Are you following me? And now, I told you, remember in the big diagram, I showed you that there's some blood coming from the upper part of the body and some blood supply coming to the heart from the lower part of the body. So there is this particular vein here called the subclavian. The subclavian vein. Now, we make use of this vein to put in pacemaker. And I will tell you what they do. What does the doctor do? They open a small incision on the chest wall. They cut open the chest wall at that position. And through this, they pass a wire into that subclavian vein, and they run that wire right into the heart. Then they connect this device, small device, about the size of a coin, onto it. In that device, there is battery and the mechanism with which it sends signals to the heart to beat. So this device now is now put under the skin, and they close the skin up. And the device, you can feel it under your skin, just there. And the cable goes into the heart, firing activities into the heart to beat, helping the SA node and the AV node to do their job when there is a problem with this. Most of the time, we use the pacemaker to deal with bradycardia. What did I say bradycardia is? When the heart beats too slowly, too sluggishly. An average heart needs to beat on the average of about 70 to 80 beats per minute. And maybe your heart is beating at 40 and you are not an athlete. Your heart is beating at 50 and you are not an athlete. It will not meet the demand because these things are not firing very well. So a device called the pacemaker is put inside the chest and the cable will run into the heart and it will help the SA node to do its job by firing electrical activity to the heart so that it can beat very, very well. I'm not going to dwell too much on this because there are still other things we need to cover in a very, very, very short program. There are several types. The doctor will determine what kind of pacemaker you need. Some has only one cable, some have two cables, which is run onto the heart, and that machine now beats. It's a very strong device. It does not just give up like every other thing, and the battery lasts very, very long. However, such things, you should be very careful when you are with other medical equipment or you are with a very big, strong magnet or you are in the airport when you go through machines, you can just let them know that you have a pacemaker in your chest and they will know how to deal with you so that your pacemaker does not develop problem under the electrical activities of the other equipment around you. Praise the living Jesus. Now, the average surgery of that takes about 1 hour, 15 minutes to implant. And the person starts feeling very, very good. You feel very, very good. Immediately feel very, very good. It still allows the heart to beat by itself, but when the heart is not coping, it steps in. It knows when to step in, and you have a fresh of breath air. Look at what Psalm 40 verses 2 and 3 says. Look at what Psalm 40 verses 2 and 3 says. He said, "He brought me up also out of the horrible pit." That is how you feel when you go on pacemaker. The way you are feeling before, the next moment when you wake up, you look as if you are a new person. "He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock, and established my going." You start feeling very, very rejuvenated, and you want to move on with life immediately. "And he had put a new song in my mouth." The Lord will put a new song in your mouth. Because when the pacemaker comes in, and you suddenly feel good about yourself, you will break up with the hallelujah unto the Lord. And you sing praises unto him in Jesus' mighty name. "Even praise unto our God, many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord." It's a miracle, even though it's in the hand of man, but it was appointed and ordained by God unto mankind. Praise the living Jesus. Other management procedures are surgeries. I told you, if we have problem with the valve, we mentioned about the valvular problems. The valves are here. When we have problems with the valve, there are two things that can be done. They could do what you call valvuloplasty. 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 Wherever you have plasty, it means repair. It means repair. They can repair the heart, valvuloplasty, the surgery to repair the valve, or valvular replacement. It can be a replacement. You can replace the heart valve. These valves, they are synthetic valves, we remove this and put a new valve, which is synthetic, made from special material, and it will be able to function very, very well. And the person will have a new, fresh breath of air. Praise the living Jesus. There's also what we call angioplasty. Plasty again, I told you it's repair. Where do we use angioplasty? This is the heart of, we discussed this under myocardial infarction and heart attack, that when you have clots within the vessel that supplies the heart, because the heart supplies the body through this big vessel, it pumps blood, fresh blood to the rest of the body through this big vessel. But from that big vessel, it takes its own supply. And when you hear heart attack, most of the time, this is the problem. When you have clot within the blood vessels of the heart itself. So they do what we call angioplasty, the repair of such thing. Sometimes they put a catheter in through the vein here or through the neck and run that pipe until it gets to where the problem is. And that pipe usually have a small balloon at the tip of it. They will be looking at it on the screen through fluoroscopy. They'll be looking at it on the screen. They'll be following the pipe. Once it gets to that point, now that balloon, now they pump from outside. The balloon pumps and opens this place where it is having problem. It opens it up. It opens it up. And sometimes they can put a stent. A stent is a very small net which they insert into that thing to stay in position. Once they get there, they inflate the balloon, inflating that small net, and keeps this vessel open so that the supply to the heart may continue. Praise the living Jesus. That is called angioplasty. The second one is called a bypass. I will talk about that in a minute. Let's just go for a break. God bless you. Welcome back. We are talking about angioplasty, coronary angioplasty. I was telling you that they run a pipe in there to blow up that place so that there is now free passage of blood to the rest of the heart. Another thing that is done to this is called the cardiac bypass. The cardiac bypass. Now, you would have had this. A famous footballer had it in Nigeria. I don't want to mention any name. He had a cardiac bypass when he was having a heart problem. Praise Jesus. Now, what do they do? When you need a cardiac bypass, let me go back to this program. Usually it's used for this. When you have the artery to the heart get blocked here. Now, and you can't supply blood to here. What do you do? You want to see, how do I bypass this problem? That is why the bypass come in. How do I bypass this problem? I would have loved to give you more details, but I will just give you a simple explanation. What they do now, they may take a graft. They may take a vein from the leg, from the saphenous vein. The saphenous vein is somewhere here. They cut a piece of it and they bring it to the heart. What do they do? This is the aorta pumping blood. This is where the heart has taken its own blood supply. But the one it took is now it's blocked. We do our own. We take another one from here. We open this big vessel, attach a vessel, another artery or vein, which we took from the leg, bring it down to go behind, to go ahead of this problem. Because the blockage is here, there's no blood here. What do? We take a graft and graft it and bring it down here. Then we say this is a bypass. We have bypassed the problem because we have taken blood supply from somewhere else and bring it down so that this place now can have their own blood supply. Is that simple enough? I'm not going to confuse you. The last surgery which is done is the heart failure itself. I mean the heart transplantation itself, whereby you take another person's heart and bring it in here. When there is no more repair, no more, nothing else that can be done about that heart, they put them on the list looking for heart. You may now ask me, where do they get the heart from? Praise Jesus. Everybody can be a donor. As a young person, you feel like, okay, look, we don't know when one will die. Jesus died at 33. John the Baptist too died in his 30s. So anybody can die at any time. But most important, let us finish the work of God that has been put in our hand. We will not die young in Jesus' mighty name. However, people in developed nations especially, they have a form where you can register to be a donor, saying that if I die, can you give my organs to those who need it? In such a case, if a young person dies, most of the time it's an accident. When they die in an accident, why they have certified them dead, most of the time brain dead, when they realize that, forget it, this person is not going to make it or have a good life after death. Once he dies, they put the person on machine for the heart to continue pumping and rush him to the hospital, and then they start harvesting. They may take the kidney and give to other people. Sometimes they take the eyes, they take the lungs, they take the liver, they take the heart. If the person who has a heart failure is on the list and he has he matches that the new donor's heart, then they give it to him and they take the heart that he has there. And I would have loved to explain the surgery to you, but we are out of time today. They take the heart and put the other heart. Such person needs to be in critical care for a while, very close monitoring with the doctor until then. Now, what does the Bible say about this? There's been a debate out there. Some people has argued that saying that God has no problem with heart transplant. Where do we find that? In John chapter 15, verses 12 and 13. John 15, verses 12 and 13. What does he say? He said, this is my commandment. That is Jesus himself talking. Now, there are people who are using this as an argument for accepting heart transplant as a Christian. He said, this is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Praise Jesus. that a man laid down his life for his friends. If you have laid down your body, said that, look, when I die, give my organs away. People are using this verse to support it. They are going to create your own opinion. Whatever I say on this part is not a personal opinion. I'm talking from pure academic ground. What you want to believe is in your hand. Praise the living Jesus. And some people have argued against it using 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. It says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. For ye are bought for a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Meaning that you don't belong to yourself, so you cannot make a decision for yourself. You cannot say you are giving your organ, is their argument. That does not mean my own belief. I'm just putting this forward for you to make up your mind where you stand in terms of heart transplantation. Praise the living Jesus. I just have one more thing to tell you. For those who are God's children, there is a promise unto them. So God will say, I will do my own surgery myself upon your heart. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26 and 26 to 38. He said, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the heart of stone, the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgment and do them. And ye shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and ye shall be my people, and I will be your God. This is the promise of God on his own surgery for your heart. May that not be your portion in Jesus' name. May that be your portion in Jesus' name. But above all, may you not have heart condition. Look out. We are going to stop the heart condition here. We are moving to a new topic. It's called sleep disorder. Don't miss it. God bless you.